Welcome to another episode of Grow with Altruist. This is a special live edition with the one and only Marguerita Cheng. We're here to discuss Asian American Pacific Islander Month, a very important month for the whole community, and we wanted to honor that here at Altruist. But before we get there, I want to introduce you to somebody that needs no introduction, Miss Marguerita Cheng, the CEO of Blue Ocean Wealth Management. Marguerita, how you doing?
Great. So excited to be here, and thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us on this show. You're an advisor that I respect, an advisor that I've seen do such great work and has empathy for communities all over the country and all over the world. That's something that I admire. So today, I just wanted to show my respect and just tell you how much I admire your work that you're doing. And I really appreciate you joining us here on the show.
Thank you so much. Those words mean so much to me because you are such an arising star, an amazing force of nature. So to hear that from you really means a lot.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. Now, Margaret, I came from a neighborhood, right? Super diverse, where I grew up in San Francisco, California. And I remember our neighborhood just being a melting pot of different cultures, right? So I had an African household on one block. We had a Hispanic section of our neighborhood. And then we had Asian and Pacific Islanders on the other side. We would all go to like the same elementary school and we would like share foods, cultures, and different practices. And that really was my introduction to the Asian American Pacific Islander culture. In fact, I feel like I know more Filipino foods than, you know, any other food out there, right? And I have so many friends of different cultures and backgrounds. It's been one of the best things that could have happened to me, right? To be introduced to these different perspectives and people, right? So I wanted to just learn about you outside of the practice, learn about your upbringing, right? And have everybody else learn about you as well.
Sure. So, well, my name is Marguerita Maria Cheng, and my dad was born in China, left China, and went to university in Taiwan. My dad, in today's terminology, we would say he was a refugee. He had to flee his hometown. And my dad doesn't really talk about this a lot. It's actually quite painful. But I know that they left their hometown in southern China with rice sacks filled with oranges, rice, and gold bars. In fact, my dad does add a little wholesome humor. He's like, I'm a southerner. And that means I'm from southern China. So I digress. Dad attended university in Wisconsin. That was very unusual then because he was sponsored by the Jesuits. And then in Wisconsin, he met a recruiter because dad studied applied mathematics. He was part of the skilled labor that was allowed to pursue higher education in America in the 60s. And then he was allowed to immigrate. He was recruited to work at IBM, and that's where he met my mom in New York. My mom is of Irish and Eastern European heritage. So I was born 90 miles north of the city, that is New York City, and many of my dad's family lived in Queens.
Okay.
So that's kind of my upbringing. I attended elementary school in New York, as well as the Netherlands. And then when I came back stateside, I moved to Texas. Wow, that was like a culture shock for me. And then I also had the opportunity to attend school in Maryland, so the DMV, moved to Japan, and then I came back to Maryland to pursue higher education. So I say that to say is not only am I multiracial, but I really am multicultural.
Yeah. It's interesting. First of all, you've been all around the world, literally black, right? So that's incredible. How did you balance growing up with these two different cultures, right? Like you had the Irish Eastern European, but then you had an Asian dad who pretty much, as you said, immigrated from there to the United States. Was that a balancing act for you?
Sure. I didn't realize it at the time because you grow up, you're always around different people. So my grandmother lived with us. This is very typical. Or not unusual. My grandmother lived with us. My grandmother, that means my dad on my mom, my grandmother on my dad's side. And she would speak to us in Mandarin. And I understood, but sometimes I'd answer in English. And then, you know, I had my mom's relatives. So on the one hand, you know, I was raised Christian, but we would also celebrate Chinese New Year. So we would burn incense and celebrate both cultures. My dad said this. He's like, what you want is you don't want to throw away the good aspects of your culture and keep the bad aspects of one culture. You want to keep the best of both worlds. Growing up, you know, I think that many times we take things for granted. You and I share this story. Yeah. You know, we have always have extended family and relatives. You don't really know if they're your aunties or uncles, or if you just call them auntie and uncle out of respect, right? Mm-hmm. So I learned at a young age to be comfortable just talking to strangers, right? And people who are different from me, which is a very important skill to become a financial advisor. I learned, I guess, what we call appreciative inquiry, right? How to ask open-ended questions without judging people. But there were times when I did experience tension. So an example is I saw many of my classmates get money for straight A's. Now, I was smart enough to know I shouldn't ask my dad for money for getting a good report card. But I recall him saying, and remember, I was smart enough to know not to ask. He would say this, your job is to perform. My job is to put food on the table, clothes on your back, and a roof over your head. So sometimes I was thinking, wow, the world is very different. But I really wasn't resentful. I was genuinely intrigued by these differences.
No, absolutely. First of all, you said that you talk to everybody, and I believe it. Right? You talk to you. You just create light and energy, and that's something that I've noticed since the first time that we've had a conversation. Now, I wanted to talk about the industry specifically, right? In your research, you found that there's not a lot of Asian American Pacific Islander CFP professionals or financial planners in general. Talk to us about why it is so important that this representation exists within our industry.
Sure. So there's diversity and inclusion, and then there's equity and representation. And it is important. Diversity, you know, I can't take credit for this, but it is true. It means inviting people to the party. Inclusion mm-hmm. is inviting to dance. Equity means having them be part of the planning committee, making sure that you're respectful of their dietary restrictions and preferences. Representation means that they're there and they help create the playlist, right?
I love that.
So I'm taking it to a whole new level. I think that it is very important to understand that the demographics of America are changing, right? And the conversation of what a wealth manager looks like is also important to change. And then the conversations about wealth. You know, I studied finance in East Asian language and literature. And while I didn't know that there was a distinct profession or track of personal finance, I started to reflect and say, why is it some people in my community are able to be stronger financially versus others? And it was, of course, access, mm-hmm. not just access to resources, but access to education and support. And I decided that that was really important to make that my why. Why am I doing this? And then as I started to become involved, I had some mentors who told me, Rita, I know you're really busy, but you want to be involved. You don't want to just join these associations. Yeah. And I'll just say this, you got to be very careful what you tell Marguerita to do, because I am very obedient. If you tell me to do X, I'm going to do X, and I'm probably going to do Y and Z, because I'm going to take it to a whole new level. So I said to myself, if I'm going to be involved in this profession, I am not going to try to push anybody out. Make no mistake. I'm just pulling more people in. I am making room for others, because if they decide they don't want to be in the profession, that's their choice. But I don't think it's appropriate for us or anybody to decide who belongs here and who doesn't.
No, I agree with that 100%. And access is important. And sometimes you need to see somebody that looks like you to even believe that it's possible to be in the profession, right? One of the things that I live by is a motto, and I say this on the podcast and I'll say it again, it's called push-pull. Essentially, what this is doing is saying that I have a responsibility to to push those ahead of me further, root them on, be their cheerleader, continue to strive towards greatness, onward to greatness, as I'll say. And then I have also the responsibility to pull those behind me through the same path that I've been able to trailblaze, right? And I think that goes to show, that goes for any culture, any community, right? These are the responsibilities that we have and we kind of owe to our people. And I think that you're doing a great job at that with your practice. I wanted to just talk about Asian American Pacific Islander Month. Let's talk about that. In the pre-notes, you talked about like how it started. Give our people a primer watching today as to what that means and how it all got started.
So, well, first, people may be asking why the month of May. And I can tell you in the month of May, so May 7th, 1843, to be exact, that is when the first Japanese immigrants came to America. Then in May of 1869, this is when the first transcontinental railroad was built. And this was built with Chinese labor. Now, people may say that's not unskilled labor. I'm sorry, laying tracks is backbreaking work, and that's skilled labor. So I just want to be clear here, folks. And so initially in 1978, it was called Asian Pacific American Heritage Week, but then we got a month and right. Then it was rebranded in 2009 to Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month. Okay. But we want to be inclusive. Some people may also say Asian Pacific Islander Desi American Heritage Month. And the reason why is we want to be mindful and we want to be inclusive to our South Asian brothers and sisters from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Nepal. If I left anybody out, so sorry. Point is, Desi Americans, we want to be inclusive of those from South Asia.
That's an amazing primer, even for me, right? I didn't know it dated that far back. Let's talk about that, right? You listed a bunch of different regions, a bunch of different types of Asian heritages, right? How do you respect these cultural nuances within the industry, right? Because when you say Asian, I don't know if people are thinking about those groups, right? They're thinking about whatever they've known to be Asian in their experience. So how, as advisors, as an industry, right, or just as a country, how do we respect those subtle cultural nuances?
So sure. So the first thing I was going to say, many times in America, when we think Asian, we often think East Asian and we think about China because that's the biggest country. But not everybody who's East Asian is going to be Chinese, right? So if you're not sure, I would say the most important thing is to be like more global nature, Asian. The other thing I want people to be mindful of, whatever you do, don't say the word Oriental. I understand people use that in the past, but it's not really the most appropriate word to use. In fact, sometimes it actually is perceived as having a racist feel to it. And President Obama actually put legislation in place for people in the federal government to no longer use the term Oriental. The preferred term is Asian American, Asian Pacific Islander. So I would say the takeaway is that when you use the term Asian, it is East Asians, it could be South Asians, Southeast Asians, and then let's not exclude people from the Pacific Islands. So our Pacific Islanders, there are more than 50 ethnic groups in many languages, and there's going to be a lot of diversity in terms of not just language, but religion and family dynamic, even geographical diversity. So there's going to be a lot of diversity. And I would say, you know, it's okay if you don't know. This is what I say. You want to learn to listen. You want to listen to learn. I think that, you know, I'm a financial advisor, and it's really important that sometimes people learn not to make assumptions. It's important to be mindful of cultural nuances, but not make assumptions. So here's what I mean. Asians in general are perceived, as being, particularly Asian women. Like, I've had people come up to me, and I'm in tune to this, who have told me that, like, I'm not aggressive enough, or I'm not going to be successful. And they're entitled to their opinion. But what I want people to know is that excellence can take many forms. In our culture, because I'm gonna say that I'm representing Asian Americans, we're taught to be a little bit more humble. We're taught to work for the group. So in financial services, that could be perceived as being a weakness. Like, she's not competitive. She's not cutthroat. I'm not competitive. I'm not cutthroat. But let me tell you, I'm collaborative, and together we're going to do more. So the takeaway is just be mindful of, you know, people's values, right? You don't have to necessarily agree with them, but understand. And that's important when you're dealing with people's money. You know, if I'm coming full circle, I had someone come up to me one day. They're like, Rita, I need your help. I'm like, sure. They're like, true story. What is wrong with these Asian people? They don't want to save for retirement. And I said, whoa, let's take a step back here. Can you replay the conversation step by step? Come to find out, it is true in my culture that education has been what has helped people advance. Mm-hmm. So you may find a family who has resources, but they will prioritize their resources to their kids' education over retirement. Why? Because they feel, and I know that this is changing because there's people who have been here a couple generations, but overwhelmingly speaking, filial responsibility is very strong in our community. So if I look at my grandma didn't have a lot of money. I told you how my dad came to America. Her retirement plan was her three children. And I understand that's changing. But where I'm going with this is that when you're working with people and they are an advisor, or maybe you're working with people who are prospects, just be mindful of their values and their community, because they're not just making a decision for themselves and they're not just planning for themselves. If they can't make a decision, please don't misunderstand that inability to make a decision with indecisiveness. It's just there's other people along the way that are affected by those decisions. So I hope that was helpful.
That was helpful. You said so many things that stuck out to me. One of the things that you said was like, they're not making a decision for themselves. And I remember being on a podcast last year in the heat of the pandemic, and I was talking to the host, and I told the host that I am a multi-generational curse breaker. And what that means to me is that a lot of what I want for my family rests on my back, right? My mom and my dad came from Liberia. They gave me a great start. Now I'm carrying the baton and hopefully passing it on to the next person with a much better start. So I completely resonate with that. Another thing that you said that was beautiful is that excellence comes in many forms. And I think that can be applied to so much that's happened over the course of this last year. For the parent that is working at home, taking care of the kids, for the advisor trying to make sure that the firm is serving their clients in the best way possible, all the way down to the person that is just trying to make sure the office facilities are clean, we see, right? Excellence comes in every form, and that deserves acknowledgement and respect. One thing that I wanted to talk about, I know that we're coming close to time here, is just the recent events with Asian hate crimes, right? As a person of African heritage, how can we stand, all communities, stand in solidarity with the Asian American Pacific Islander community as they go through this time?
Sure. Thank you so much for this. And, you know, the reason I told you a little bit about the cultural nuances is, you know, even though I'm generation 1.5, meaning I was born here, but I'm straddling two generations, I, you know, embody of what my dad instilled in me. We are very proud to be here. We're very proud Americans. We are Americans. We may look like outsiders, but even though we don't complain about what's happening, it is still happening. And the reason why we don't complain is because whether you agree with the model minority or not, there's a lot of pressure on us, because at one point we were considered, I'm saying East Asians, that is Chinese, we're considered the yellow peril. And then in the 60s, before 1965, it was unskilled labor. Then people realized, you know, we are good, hardworking people. We look different, but we work hard too, right? I'm saying we because I'm putting us in the group. So just because you don't hear of this, don't think that it's not happening. These things have been happening a while. We just put our head down and work. And I'll just say this, I've had to educate people in my family, because remember, I'm multiracial, I'm multicultural, that were like, man, I didn't realize this was happening. When did this start happening? And I have to sit them out and say, you know, this has been happening since like the late 1800s, like not being able to come, even in the picture of the Transcontinental Railroad, they didn't allow the Chinese laborers to be in that picture. So not only were we discriminated against, sometimes we weren't included. So the conclusion is, I hope that people recognize that these things have been happening a while. It doesn't make it right. But together we can stop AAPI hate by advocating. The other thing is, it is so important for all of us. So it means everybody from AAPI, Latino, Hispanic, Black, African American, to support one another. There is me supporting Dasarte and other advisors of diverse background is not taken away from my success. Agreed. Together, we support, elevate, and celebrate.
I love it. I love it. And we support you here at Altruist. And that's why we wanted to have this special edition. We thought that you were the perfect person to talk about this subject, given your multiracial, multicultural experience. And we appreciate you coming on the show. To just end this on a light note with grow, right? I plan on seeing the industry change over the course of the next 3 to 5 to 10 years. What do you hope for? What do you hope to see in the industry over the next 5 years?
So what I hope is, I hope that more people who look like us understand that this profession needs them. This profession doesn't just need them, but we support them. The other thing is, I want people to know, remember I said excellence comes in many forms. I was moved to tears when somebody, a young woman of South Asian descent, sent me an email. And she said to me, Rita, when I met you, I was thinking I didn't belong. I thought I couldn't be successful because I was empathetic, but I realized that there's room for people like me to be successful in finance. That's what I'm talking about. I want all of us to receive more emails from people like that, that I know I belong, and I am so excited to be here to advance the profession and benefit society.
Yeah, absolutely. One of my favorite musicians said, he might not change the world, but he might inspire the heart that does. And I see you doing that in the work that you do every single day. Rita, we appreciate you. Before I let you go, where can people find you? Where can they catch up with you on the social media? Or if they want to learn more about your firm, where can they do that?
So sure, on Twitter, at BlueOceanGW, LinkedIn, Marguerita Cheng, the one and only. No, seriously, I don't spell it like the drink, but you pronounce it like the drink. I'm sure you'll find me. And then last but not least, blueoceanglobalwealth.com.
Awesome. Well, thank you again, Marguerita. I really appreciate you. It's an honor. And thank you all for joining us on this special edition of Grow with Altruist Live. Make sure to follow us on Twitter at Altruist and on LinkedIn as well. And if you want to be a part of the network, feel free to visit altruist.com/grow. I'm your host, Dasarte Yarnway. We'll see you again here very soon.